Thank you very much, and thank you for staying online after the lunch dip or late in the evening. Thank you very much. I'm going to talk about commoditization of functions and differentiation by non-functionalities. Maybe a cryptic title, but non-functionalities very much include cybersecurity. This is the content of my story. Yeah. First, we have to take a broader perspective and look what industry has created in terms of IoT. And on the one hand, it has created tremendous opportunities, but at the same time, it has created issues such as the non-functional issues. I'm going to talk about the perspectives of stakeholders, and then we talk about business perspective, education perspective, governance perspective, and society. And we've already seen some excellent presentations earlier today. Then I will switch in a more positive mode because cybersecurity, in my view, is not, let's say, a hygiene factor. It's a differentiation opportunity, which we should embrace. And I think it will be very interesting for businesses, for education, for government, and society. Yeah. Last but not least, architectures. We heard a lot about, let's say, functional approaches to cybersecurity, but there's also something like system architecture, which plays a crucial role. And I will end with some conclusions. First, opportunities and issues that have been created by industry, yeah, and the trends. So where did we start from 25, 30 years ago? Moore's Law, high volume electronics, and we have created lots of programmable commodities. We have seen the same in communication technologies, ever-increasing bandwidth, and that has resulted in incredible functionalities at low cost, exponential change. Yeah? Which also led to tremendous competition, and in the end, you have room for only a few players in the component manufacturing. And this is the smile curve. Maybe you remember it, the smile curve was invented in the 80s, where on the one hand you see the value, and on the other hand you see the position in your value chain. And you see on the left the technology companies, the hardware companies, the semiconductor manufacturers, where there are happy few. On the right hand, you see the many companies that are enabled by these standard commodities, and they actually, they're also happy because they make new businesses based on those standard components. And in the middle, you better get out or you are playing in a niche. Actually, this is the definition of a platform. On the right hand side, you see the people embracing and building on platforms that have been created by the left hand side. And actually, this is very much also the story from this morning from Mr. Friedman, that how do we secure that you have insight in what those platforms provide to you? Do we have an insight in the software behind it? This is not only about hardware, this is very much the same for software. Now, what is the result? In the 21st century, we see a massive deployment, we see a large contribution to economic growth, we see many industries that are focusing on competition by functionality. Yeah. And functionality, I mean that you get more colors, you get more functions. I can do this, I can switch on that motor, I can switch it off remotely, all those functions. Yeah. And I make a bold comparison with the 17th century. This is basically the century of, in the 17th century, we had the beads and mirrors that we used to trade with people in Africa, for instance, yeah, in return of valued goods from that country. And this is basically the same what's happening today. Yeah. In my view, consumers trade privacy and some of their autonomy in return of functionalities they get, not only on their iPhone, but also in Internet of Things. Yeah. It's functionality in return of your privacy, your data, et cetera. This will come back in my story. Yeah. If you look to these smile curves, actually history has repeated itself. It's not a single smile curve. Actually, on the crossing of each of the smile curves, you see that platforms are created and a whole new industry is building on that platform in order to create new propositions. Yeah, we have the semiconductor industry, we have the microprocessor industry, we have the software industry, we have the application industry, and actually the value is going up exponentially, but you have to pick your place in the value chain. This is a chain of functional approaches. And in my view, there has been very little attention on the non-functionalities, across the chain. And non-functionalities include cybersecurity, but there are more. The other thing is that secure components from the left don't make a secure system. Yeah? You can have a perfect chip, but if you put it in an application that is not secure, or you have software around it that is not secure, or you have human behavior that is not secure, you can still have an issue in your system non-functional approach. Yeah? The scale actually increases exponentially. You can have one chip on the left that is applied in a million applications on the right. So the scale itself also gives a huge exposure. Yeah. So this is the issue that has been created as well by the industry. On the one end, we see tremendous opportunities by commoditization. On the other end, you see an issue by the ever-increasing scale and the dependency on the left-hand side. Now, the main issues in IoT, so we have all these functional advantages, lots of value, but the issues are non-functional ones. And we have privacy, security, upgradability, dependency, portability, you name it. You can summarize them as the itties. And they have often been neglected in the whole value chain. Yeah? And repairing them afterwards is extremely difficult. Yeah? And the security issue comes predominantly of the scale. I already mentioned we have exponential growth of applications on the right-hand side of that smile curve. Yeah? So apart, even if the risk of occurrence is pretty low, yeah, the impact, if you can control all those devices from a central system or from one hack, is enormous. Yeah? So impact has created our problem and our dependency on an Internet of Things. Yeah? Apart from that, you also see that the scale itself also creates an additional risk, because if you're small, you're not interesting for hackers. And the time you get bigger and bigger, you get more interest from hackers. Yeah? I remember that from my work with Philips Lighting. As soon as we got some traction in the market with Philips Hue, the personal lighting system, you saw enormous increase of attention by hackers. But they're simply looking for the largest opportunity to hack. Yeah. So here are some general statements. Yeah? I start with a very abstract statement, but I will translate it into something that is really meaningful for cybersecurity. My statement is that the non-functional elements, so all these itties, yeah, and in particular cybersecurity, are no longer an aspect of IoT, but they are of the core of its success. Yeah? And the functional elements, where all the businesses have focused on, have more buttons, more colors, more inches, etc., they're becoming commodities. Yeah? Basically, you can order anything on the internet to make a functional smart home, or to make a functional smart city, or to make a functional whatever smart. Yeah? But the non-functional aspects, you can't order on the internet. Yeah? That's where you have to invest on. The other thing is that not all non-functional issues need to be the same for the same functional performance. Now, this sounds cryptic, but there are a thousand ways of creating your smart home, or your smart city, or your smart office with an Internet of Things. Yeah. But and in functionality, they don't differ. But there can be tremendous difference in the non-functional aspects, in privacy, in security. Yeah. So not every system with the same functionality has the same cybersecurity risk. And basically, this is what you call, in technical terms, system architecture. We have to think about how to construct our system. So let's look at the stakeholder perspectives over time and how they develop. And you heard already quite some good examples from government, for instance, earlier today. Yeah. Business. Historically, the business has focused on functionalities, often ignoring the non-functionalities. And why? Because they wanted to reduce the bill of materials. Yeah. And paying attention to all these, let's say, clean effects or the necessaries is only cost. Yeah. There has also been ignorance. People coming from a hardware background often neglect the risks of software. Yeah. There has been a device focus sometimes and a lack of internet. And then people refer to, yeah, that's the internet. They have to take care of the security. I only make devices. Well, actually, that is a lack of system view. Yeah. And the other thing is that many businesses see an opportunity in short-term replacement of goods. So why would they work on upgrades? Why would they make something secure for the long term? They rather sell you a new product. Yeah. But now you see that cybersecurity is emerging as a hygiene factor. Yeah. but initially with minimal investment, yeah, much of the time is delegated to the key component supplier. This is exactly the issue that was mentioned this morning. And you don't see many dedicated staff in those companies. Yeah? What we now see is also the first movers in IoT systems, so the companies that really focus on applications in smart home, smart office, etc., they're often excused for incidents. Yeah? They say, oh, sorry, we didn't think about it, we have to repair it. But that means that they're learning very fast. The followers, they're very, very anxious to get in the same situation, so they hold back. But that means they don't learn, and they lose out against competition. So we have to create an environment where you have a controlled learning, even including cybersecurity. Yeah? So let's say a smart city area where all the participants are aware of the risk and that we have fast repair. Yeah? This leads to trust perception or trust. And I think that trust is becoming a differentiation factor and even a competitive edge for companies. But trust is not something that you can just switch on and off. You can decide to add more colors, or you can decide to add more inches to a screen, or you can decide to add more functionality and switch on and off more lamps. Yeah? But trust is not something that you can switch on and off. Trust is something that really requires a very long-term, consistent strategy. Yeah? That's how people say, trust comes by foot and leaves by horse. If you make one mistake, you can kill your whole proposition. Still, I believe that this is really an opportunity for the business, but this long-term strategy is rather uncommon in the Anglo-Saxon business culture. We are short-termish. We look at short-term results on the stock market, but I think this has to change into a much more sustainable model. Education. Yeah. I was educated as an electronics engineer, and the prime focus in my education was on building functionalities. Yeah? And engineers were seen as drivers, and we had some naggers that were always bugging about quality. And actually, initially, we didn't have these people watching for quality. Yeah? I think that's now changing, and we've seen that at the Eindhoven University already a few years ago. They started what they call T and Pi profile engineers, people that take a system perspective, people that are able to connect things on a higher aggregation level. Yeah? Multidisciplinary, but very much looking also at the non-functional system aspect. And I think that all curricula basically should include knowledge on cybersecurity and non-functional aspects of system, because we depend so much more on systems towards the future that you cannot assume that I can do it, the I profiles, yeah? Which also holds for me. Yeah? Now we switch to government. I think we have seen an excellent presentation this morning on the Dutch government. I think there's a strong awareness about the risk, and we have seen actually this morning there was an additional publication that the government is very active in creating awareness, in creating rules, etc. And for instance, what was really, really eye-opening is that even in large companies and in larger medium enterprises, the people that work there have actually very little notion of the risks of cybersecurity, while in practice, 1 in 5 companies every year is attacked on the cybersecurity level. Yeah? So this is quite serious. Society, yeah? The end user. Yeah? We have professional users, but we also have consumers, and actually consumers drive very much the early introduction of IoT. Yeah? I see their paranoia and inconsistency. I see inconsistency in the sense that people return their privacy, or the given return their privacy for beads and mirrors of the 21st century. So they buy a very cheap camera, or they buy a toy which has an IoT connection. And because it's such attractive from a functional point of view, they don't care about privacy security issues. Yeah? But on the other hand, I see sometimes an overreaction when it comes to really good applications for common interest. And recently we had a discussion on a COVID-19 app, which is with privacy regulations, tracking people, helping them to get out of risk areas where people can actually transfer viruses. Yeah. What we also see is that consumers in general are not prepared to pay for for the ITIs, for security. They're looking for the cheapest functionality. And of course, I already mentioned that from the government report, they overestimate their security. Yeah. But I see a change. People are becoming educated, and in their eyes, trust and security are now being valued, which I think is the moment for companies to think, should we work on it? Should we use this as a differentiator? So, cybersecurity is really a differentiation opportunity, as many other functionalities, by the way. Yeah. And I've made a pictorial of that. Yeah. Some people say, well, the functional thinking is the opposite of non-functional approaches. That's not true. Actually, it's perpendicular. It's orthogonal. Yeah. So, of course, without functions, you cannot think about non-functional ideas and the other way around. Yeah. So, if you make an abstract view of this, then the new value space is actually a very nice combination of the non-functional aspect on the one hand and the functional aspect on the other hand. Yeah? And the non-functional aspect requires a long-term value by the non-functionals, competition on trust and differentiation aspect. The functional aspects more and more become short-term a commoditization and a competition on price. Yeah? Now, of course, you cannot make money on only one axis. So it depends where you want to play. Yeah? Are you continuing your functional approach with relatively low attention to the non-functional aspects, or you want a bigger surface area, a bigger value in general, by combining the two? And I think this is the way to go. System architectures. I promise you to come back to that aspect. Yeah? The zillion IoT sensors and actuators, they pose a major system security issue. Yeah? So you can try to prevent hacks, but the other way is to moderate the impact of the inevitable hacks. We already heard previously that it's more or less impossible to avoid that things will be hacked, but you may be able to reduce the impact. Yeah? And this is very much why we should work on distributed architectures versus centralized architectures. Yeah? They have the same functionality, but they have very different non-functional behaviors, yeah? Which requires that the end nodes are not stupid sensors and actuators that can be controlled from one central point, but there should be a minimal intelligence in end nodes or intermediate nodes to take decisions autonomously. Let's look at the smart city. Yeah? Two examples of architectures. Yeah? On the one hand, you see a tree architecture with a central point and deploying information and control to individual nodes. On the right-hand side, you see the mesh or swarm, yeah? Which is actually that every node is communicating with the other nodes, but it has a certain autonomy. Now, if you look at the tree on the one hand and the swarm or the mesh on the other side, how would you hack them? Now, it's very simple. You only need one chainsaw to cut the tree. Yeah? So if you're able, in a central way, to put in a hack, then you're able to actually to screw the whole system. But you should really try to hack a swarm architecture with autonomous intelligence in every node. This is much more difficult. Now, I'm not saying this is a simplistic picture. I'm not saying that this is as simple as this. But I think there's a tremendous opportunity to think about architectures that are really different from our internet architecture today. And what you will get for distributed system is much better resilience, yeah? A higher value and cost for the end nodes, which is nice for the companies that work on these commodities, because actually those nodes, those chips, the software gets more value. Yeah? Of course, there's a higher cost, but it gets so much more value that this is really compensated. Yeah? So people can escape from the commodity trap. Yeah? Also in these systems, you have collective learning, but you have local authority. Yeah? Another advantage is that you don't need to send all the raw data to central points. You can locally process your data and actually send the outcome to a central point, which saves a lot of traffic and probably also a lot of power. Yeah? And you can create much more local ownership of data. So you can better protect privacy because you're not sending all the raw data. You're only sending what is need to be sent at the time that you decide yourself. Yeah. Also from a power point of view, but it's a different aspect. I think it has tremendous advantages to look at distributed architectures. Yeah. But very much we need that we are able to preserve, that we provide updates for all those nodes, and that you include supervision of those networks and nodes, whatever architecture you have, which is called autonomous adaptive security. And AI will help in that sense very much. I come to the conclusions. Yeah. First, functional performance has driven innovation and competition for decades, and everyone is used to it. Yeah. But it's so much commoditizing that for only for a few companies there's fun in it, and particularly in IoT. Yeah. The non-functionalities, in my view, will create sustainable value, and that's where the focus needs to shift. Yeah. An integral systems approach, new engineering competencies, architectural thinking, and long-term strategy are essential, which is not for just one company or one government. It's really a value chain approach and multidisciplinary collaboration. Yeah. And the IoT cybersecurity is an issue that one can turn into an opportunity, a real business opportunity. Thank you very much.